Kurtis, Harry Porterfield, John Coughlin, Johnny Morris, and Walter Jacobson's perspective on the Channel 2 News at 6.
Good evening. Chicago is still talking about last night's disturbance at Comiskey Park, a wild melee involving thousands of people who jammed the stands for a White Sox doubleheader and a promotional stunt by an anti-disco disc jockey. John Quinones will report on the disturbance and its aftermath and have reaction from some of those involved in the incident. Also this evening, John Drummond will report on a tense confrontation at the El Rukns Temple, headquarters of a cult that police say is the latest version of what once was called the Black Keystone Nation Gang. There is some good news tonight. The DC-10s are flying again with the blessing of the FAA. Top story tonight, that incident at Comiskey Park last night. The disturbance came during a promotional stunt by WLUP radio station disc jockey Steve Dahl. Our John Quinones was at the Steve scene and has a report on the disturbance from the start.
It was billed as Disco Demolition Night, and thousands of the rock DJ's followers swarmed into the ballpark. By 7:30, there were already signs of impending trouble. The doubleheader was sold out, standing room only. Some 12,000 baseball and rock music fans, most of them teenagers, were turned away. And many of them didn't like that. It was a standoff between the fans trying to get into the ballpark and security people trying to keep them out. By the time the gates were finally shut, the first ball game was over, and attention was turned to the star attraction of the evening. Steve Dahl, the self-proclaimed leader of the so-called anti-disco army, proceeded with a featured event, the disco demolition. Except for some sporadic fireworks and the chanting of anti-disco slogans, up until then, the crowd was relatively under control. But just after Dahl left the field, a few youngsters jumped onto it. More and more followed. Soon, there was chaos. Records flew like frisbees, more fireworks exploded, bottles were thrown, and an estimated 7,000 spectators staged their very own demolition. 4 fans were injured during the melee, 40 others arrested. And even after the disturbance was quelled, ballpark area residents aired their own complaints.
I had to chase 2 boys out of my hall that was urinating in it. And also, we had a car on the curb by our house.
Have you ever had anything like this?
We had it last year when they had a disco going on here. We're all constantly cleaning our halls and our streets here with beer cans from these people coming here. We got a nice neighborhood, and this is our livelihood right here. We live here. We keep it clean.
This morning, cleanup crews tried to repair the damage on the infield, but on the 37th floor of the Hancock building, it was business as usual for Steve Dahl and his anti-disco campaign.
Now, we didn't do this thing last night for as a publicity stunt, but it sure is turning into one, isn't it?
Oh, you think so?
And what the heck? I'll do whatever you want, you know? Just as long as they spell your name wrong. It's the old adage.
That'd be pretty funny.
I don't know what to tell you. I didn't see it when they came out. I didn't see that many bottles or that many records flying, so I don't know. You know, there were some people that got a little carried away, and...
But you're not taking responsibility for what happened.
I don't think I have to. I haven't done anything. I packed Bill Veeck's baseball stadium for him, made him a lot of money last night, did my job, everybody liked it, I left. People wanted to come on the field, and their security people couldn't keep him in the stands.
You'd do it all over again?
Not a security guard.
Would you do it over again?
Yeah, with more security guards.
No. Police are at a loss in trying to explain what happened last night.
Everybody's looking for a fault. I don't think anybody actually planned to have a riot or planned to have problems. I think it was probably some good methodology to get a crowd, but it overworked. It was like a person puts an ad in a paper to sell something and they run out of goods. There's not enough goods.
After the second game of the doubleheader was called off last night, spectators were told, keep your rain checks. But it is still unclear whether that second game will be forfeited. Channel 2's Bruce Roberts will have a live interview with the White Sox's president later in this newscast.
Report on the aftermath of that melee out there last night. Bruce?
Harry, everything is all quiet now, sort of routine in the batting cage, but that demonstration here last night has hurt the Sox chances immeasurably. About 4:30 this afternoon, we were interviewing Bill Veeck up in the Bards room. That interview was interrupted by a telegram handed to the Sox president, sent by American League President Lee McPhail. After he read it, Veeck had this comment.
Well, I talked to Lee McPhail. I got a teletype. It says, it was a judgment of the umpires that it was not possible to start the second game of the July 12th doubleheader because of inadequate crowd control and damage to the playing field, both of which were specific responsibility of the home team. It is therefore required of me that I declare this game forfeited to Detroit by a score of 9-0. This game should not be rescheduled.
And what were your immediate thoughts?
Well, my immediate thoughts were that the umpires were, of course, wrong. No one came onto the field during the course of a game. And so they threw some things. They throw things in every ballpark that I've ever been in, and they didn't forfeit the game. And the crowd was cleared from the field in time to start the second game of the doubleheader. And the field was not in unplayable condition. There was a strip of grass missing from in front of the pitcher's mound, which was filled with dirt, which made an extension merely of the skin part of the mound. And that's the only thing that was wrong with the diamond. And we have played in many worse fields than the one last night. So I think that the game should have been played, and there was no possible grounds for forfeiting it.
Now for the player's side of the picture, one of the Sox reps with us on our left, Alan Bannister. Alan, you were here, you saw it, and so did the players. Do you feel there were grounds for canceling that second game?
Well, I think there was grounds for eliminating the possibility of playing the game that particular night, last night. I think even when they got the fans back into the stands, they were still the same fans, and they were still a little riotous and a little, one Sox executive called it festive. I wouldn't think that was accurate, but I really think that there was something in the air that was really violent last night, and I thought it was a good idea to eliminate any more possibilities, and I think that meant canceling the game.
The players all feel the same way?
The players, they weren't terribly concerned with what would happen, the consequences, whether it be a forfeiture, whether we'd have to reschedule. They were only concerned with right now, and at that particular moment, it was dangerous out there, and I don't think any of the players on the team with Detroit or our ball club wanted to go out there on the field at that particular time.
Have you ever seen anything like this in all your life?
No, I really haven't. In fact, about the second or third inning of the first game, you could start feeling it in the air, that you could look up in the grandstands and notice that the majority of the people weren't even watching the game. They were busy throwing things or doing something else except participating in the Sox baseball game. So I just felt sure that something was going to happen, and I kind of thought they might cancel the between game activities, but they
didn't.
That's
what we thought. You would wonder why they didn't.
Well, you could just almost feel it coming.
Yeah,
and
so why didn't they cancel it? That's management's decision, you would think.
Right. I'm sure they got reasons for doing what they did. I thought they would cancel it, and they didn't. As it turned out, disastrous. And of course, when one person comes down on the field, everybody thinks, well, it's okay now, let's all go. And it was a desperate situation. A lot of the players were terribly concerned with their families and loved ones in the stand. And rightfully so. A lot of wives were told to go home, and they couldn't. They couldn't get out of the gate. So they were stuck here, and they weren't safe in the stands. They weren't safe sitting in their cars. So it was kind of a precarious situation.
I would think so. I see Don Kissinger waiting for you. There's a meeting. Do appreciate it, Alan,
okay,
for your thoughts and the thoughts of the players. You should have seen, well, you did see the field after that tremendous demonstration. The man whose seemingly monumental job was to get this field ready for tonight's game, White Sox groundskeeper Roger Bossert. Here's what he had to say.
Well, Bruce, we were out here this morning, Dad and myself, at about 20 after 5. And I can say that after last night, as far as the groundskeeper's concerned, it was a nightmare.
Well, what would you have to do?
Well, we had to put in about 170 yards of sod, mostly in center field where the kids had their little bonfire. We had to put a little bit in front of the pitcher's mound where they tore some out, and other little divots around the field. But I'd like to say it really wasn't all that bad. There was a lot of work, but considering for having 4,000 or 5,000 kids on the field, you expect damage, but we're in good shape, and we didn't think it was really all that bad.
Oh, no. That's the story of last night's game. Incidentally, the Sox lost that first game 4-1. Tonight, they'll send Ross Baumgartner against the Tigers. In Cincinnati, it'll be Dennis Lamp against Freddie Norman. The Cubs, by virtue of their five runs in the ninth inning, beat the Reds 10-8. What a remarkable rally. For